I'm always talking about plants. Because I get a kick out of them. Matter of fact, sometimes some people think that I like plants more than I like people. Maybe. Okay. Maybe plants are a little easier to deal with than people, because people talk back and talk at you and sometimes talk to you. Have you ever noticed those words, you know, talk at you or talk about you, you know, or talk to you? You know, funny how one word in that sentence can change the meaning. Often we discover when I'm dealing with plants that what environment I put the plants in either helps them to grow, causes them to grow, or quite frankly stalls them from growing. Like if it's chilly and cold out, my plants don't grow so good. Sometimes they even die because of the cold. If I keep them warm and inside this little plastic area I got, then they start to grow, but they don't really develop fully. The fact of what happens when I get some of these huge blooms like you see behind me is a combination of things. It's just the right amount of sunshine, but it needs a lot of it. It's just the right amount of water, but it needs a lot of that too when it has a lot of sunshine. And it's kind of like the water, the word, and the sunshine of his smile, I always say. You know, it's like you need God intervening or shining upon you. You need an environment where, you know, you're at least, you know, kind of like having the sunshine, the light, you know, you're taking it in, you're doing your photosynthesis. Well, you have to have spiritual synthesis. You have to take in the things of the Spirit in order to be washed also with the water of the Word so that you could grow up into being a planting of the Lord. You know, kind of like plants. See? That's kind of why I get a kick out of them. They make sense, spiritual sense that is, to me. And Jesus used the same thing because he was dealing in a society that's agrarian. Agrarian simply means that they dealt with farming more than they dealt with technology or with industrialization. We are in a kind of post-industrialization, modernization, kind of a fractured societal, industrial, informational, computerized age that really is kind of like interesting in what it will take and try to make as opposed to what it gives and what lives. You see, my plants, they give and they live. But anything in industry takes and makes. In other words, it doesn't actually give you something and it doesn't live. Oh, it seems like it gives you more time, but really it takes more time. And it takes from something in order to make something. Like, you know, you have to have electricity for industrialization. That's just a fact of matter. And without electricity, you probably wouldn't have too much industry. A type of industry, but not the same as the industrialization age. So when I look at plants, I kind of like the fact that they know how to grow. They just grow. They just do it. When the light's on them, they're growing. When God shines his light upon you, are you growing or are you kind of like hiding from the light? Every day I look at the Word so that I can be found, you know, not just growing, not just knowing, not just doing, not just being, but actually living out what I say I believe in. Because, you see, it's easy to talk about it. It's easy to maybe walk a short distance. It's easy to kind of like act like it or pretend or contend for the faith in some way to hide something that's inside of me. But when you live out your faith day to day, as technically I do on video, it's kind of like, well, you know, you want to see reality television? Watch my video. No, I'm kidding. But when you live out your faith in front of a camera, so to speak, because I come out here every day and I spend hours and hours and hours and hours and hours doing that with which God has inspired me to do and called me and chose me and said, do this. And I go, okay. and being honest with you and truthful with everything that comes up in my life and sharing with you and, you know, trying to, like, you know, kind of make a connection and say, hey, you know, look, this is my problem. This is how I dealt with it. What did you do? You know, how did you solve your problem? You know, if you didn't solve it, here, try this. And knowing Jesus in that intimacy of Him resolving a lot of my issues sometimes helps you to resolve your issues when you talk to Him about it. And that's really where it's all about when we get together to express our faith and our love for one another, exhorting one another, encouraging one another with love and with analogies and similes to plant life and human life and spiritual life, you know, and the kind of life that God wants us to have, which is an abundant life, or abundantly filled with the presence of God, abundantly filled with peace, with love, with joy, with appreciation, with gladness, with excitement, with sometimes tears, sometimes crying, sometimes remorse, sometimes repentance. All of these things to make a fullness of life. For in the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy forevermore. And that's kind of what God wants to do is to, I always go like this because it reminds me of a heart. That's my heart symbol. Is I just go curling backwards down. Like if you just watch the hands, you can go, this is a heart. You see how it kind of like, here's the humps, you know, the heart. Just go like that. Go, and you see, the heart ends in prayer. And so my own little heart, you know, people do this little thingy like that. And I'm kind of like, well, you know, that's kind of cute. But this is mine. Mine is more like, yeah, like that. Or, you know, I'll just do it short, you know, it's kind of like that. And it's just one of those kind of things, you know, that, hey, I know who invented that. No, I'm just kidding. It's just, oh, please. But the reality, you know, the reality of God in our lives causes our hearts to be fullness of the joy that we have in expressing ourselves to our Father in Heaven. And that's why I talk with my hands, because a lot of times hand communication can expressively deliver something in a more intimate way, possibly, and have you to understand and comprehend the tone of voice as well as the excitement and joy that I feel in sharing God, Jesus, the Word of God, the Spirit of God, the things that God has placed upon my heart, the things that God has revealed and even speaking to me sometimes when I'm sitting in the back seat of my mind going, wow, where did that come from? Whoa. And that's why I choose to walk in the light as He is in the light, so that I could have fellowship with you and that you could have fellowship with me, and that together our fellowship would be encouraging. It would be exhorting. It would be challenging. It'd be wonderful. It'd be a way for us to help each other in some way along our way today. If you do return to the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the strange gods and Ashtaroth from among you, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord and serve Him only. Little children, keep yourself from idols. You know, American Idol, Warcraft, technology, you know, your job, your newfound love, your first love, your whatever, childhood sweetheart. You know, love can be an idol, believe it or not. You know, you can love love so much that you love the love rather than you love the person. Because the person has faults. Sorry. That idea of, you know, puppy love, not so good. Your idols can be a cat. It can be a dog. It can be, you know, like a lot of people today worship dogs, of all things. They dress them up. They tie them up. They take them for walks. They spend more time on their dog than they do on their kids. They spend more time on their dog than they do on their God. They spend more time with their dogs than they do on themselves. Some people do, believe it or not. Or like if your dog is in your bed, something's wrong in your head. That's what I always say. If your dog is, you know, the first thing in your sight, then there's something wrong with your sight. If the dog is always in every picture that you have, there's something wrong with that picture. Sorry, it's a dog. It's not a person. It is an animal that God created. And God created the animals for a reason. It's not necessarily for you to make an idol out of them like the Egyptians did. So, knowing that, dare we say cats too? It's like, oh no, don't touch the cats. They're too cute. Bottom line is, when people are bored and they're unwilling to deal with humanity, they'll replace them with dogs and cats. But not plants. No, that's not my idol. Or they'll replace their poor relationship skills with watching television or hiding on the internet, which, you know, people are hiding on the internet, they're making connections, but they're still cyber hiding. You know, it's kind of like a cyber kind of personality that you create so that you can be that person rather than who you really are. Because really, who are you? Are you really Johnny Jodo, you know, on the internet, or are you just, you know, trying to make a go-go for your poor relationship skills that you don't know how to talk to people anymore? You forgot how. And so I understand using technology to bridge the gap of sometimes being distant and, you know, making a relationship out of sometimes things that are on the internet. But likewise, you need to be able to talk to people too, to be face to face in the reality of who we are and being truthful and honest about our lack of knowledge of each other, but fellowshipping one with another by not making idols out of things that would separate us from God and separate us from each other. Come out from among them and be you separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord God Almighty. You can't serve God and mammon. I'm sorry. It does not work out. The argument is always made, what's mammon? Mammon is man-made. That's it. Pure and simple. Let's clarify the guts of the matter. Don't go there with money. Money is a neutral. Money is an exchange currency. It is about money, but it's about what money does, what money is, what money corrupts, what money can do, what money will do. And so when you accumulate money, you find yourself corrupted by it because there's a power behind it. It's not the issue itself, it's the power behind it. It's the same thing with this whole idea of people arguing about gun control. They want to exercise their freedom of rights to their freedom. They want to exercise their freedoms by their right to bear arms. In other words, they're fighting the spirit of rebellion. No, really, that's what they're doing, is that whether they'll admit it or not, the expression of freedom is the spirit of rebellion, because that's what it boils down to. If you're obeying God, you're doing what he says, and he doesn't tell you go out buy a gun. I'm sorry, I don't find it anywhere in scripture. No, it doesn't say go buy a sword and you think that's what it applies to. It doesn't. You know, we can get into deep Bible study and we can prove it. That's easy. That's not hard. It's only one scripture. But the point is, yes, there are people that are called to do certain jobs and functions that they're required to use technology. But using technology is not serving technology. You can't serve mammon and serve God. If you serve God, you don't need a gun. If you serve God, you don't need protection. If anything, you need to learn to lay down your life so that God could take it up for you and protect you, or take it from you and let you be a martyr for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. For we are told that the greatest of those would be the servant of all, but also that those who love not their lives even unto death were those with which God looked down upon and had great compassion and mercy towards, and moved on their behalf for the word of their testimony and the fact that they loved not their lives unto death. I was trying to think of the whole scripture, but I couldn't think of it off the top of my head. I'm kind of like, time for coffee. Can we get more coffee? Sorry, we're not in a restaurant. I guess I'm not going to be served, but I have to serve. Serve myself. But serving God, we find there's a greater joy and a greater reward, as well as a peace that doesn't come from serving mammon. Mammon will always be man-made. Money is man-made. The exchange rates, the exchange capabilities, the exchange part is man-made, man-directed, man-inspected. And so anytime you see mammon, just think man-made, and you got it. Mammon is man-made. That's all. You can't serve God at man-made. Or man. But you serve God in some ways by serving man, in some ways by doing what God said to do. So that's why mammon is man-made and not man. Does that make sense to you? I hope so. Because it really fits if you take the English word as opposed to the root word and make it applicable according to the Spirit of God as he leads you. Thou shalt worship no other god, period. For the Lord whose name is jealous is a jealous God. Serve him with a perfect heart and with a willing mind. For the Lord searches all hearts and understands all the imaginations of the thoughts. I like to use that word machinations, because there's a machination we all have where we disguise what we're doing and think we're hiding it from God. That machination is a man-made idea of trying to put a spiritual cover over a carnal desire. You know, like a Harley. Pardon me. But a Harley is not a spiritual desire. A Harley is a carnal desire with a spiritual application. People say, oh, well, you know, I'm building a Harley church for Harley riders so Harley people can get together to be Harley Christians in order to minister to those that the church can't minister to because they don't have Harleys in their church. May I say to you straightforward from the Lord, that's an idol church. Yes, you put Harley as your idol. Because a Harley is just a motorcycle. If it's a Yamaha, if it's a Kawasaki, if it's, you know, a Honda, you know, or whatever. The point is, BMW, it's an idol. It's a mammon. It's not necessarily a godly desire. Can you use it for the kingdom of heaven? Of course, you can use anything. But does it mean that you should be promoting it as such? No. I recently read on the internet something about a cowboy church. Never heard of it, you know, and there's nothing wrong with cowboy churches, there's nothing wrong with biker churches, nothing wrong with any kind of church where people are assembling together for the fellowshipping and, you know, encouraging and, you know, developing in Bible study and all that stuff and using maybe, you know, horses to go riding, you know, and find it someplace. But if you're trying to promote the horse end of it, dare I say you're following the wrong end? I think the end doesn't justify the means. God wants to work through us by all means possible, lest by any means some might be saved. And that's what Paul said, I become all things to all men, lest by any means some might be saved. You know, if you want to go ride a horse, ride a horse. You know, if you want to start a church for horses, you know, well, the horses don't need it. Maybe you do. But horse riders, I understand, you know, getting together for fellowshipping and trying to customize. But if you isolate, then maybe you're separating yourself from God, who welcomes all people together. And you might want to bring more people in to your horse church or your biker church or your idol church than what really you have now. Because if you only get people that agree with you, you're not learning. You need the disagreeable people as well as the agreeable people in order to have iron sharpen iron and brother sharpen brother in growing in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ by the relationship being sometimes frustrating, but challenging in the sense that it causes you to grow and to depend upon God and not what you know, and then wanting to encourage others with only what you know as opposed to what God wants to grow up in us. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh upon the heart. Beloved, if our heart condemns us not, then we have confidence toward God. Poke the bear. If the bear is provocable, guess what? It ain't godly. In other words, if you can be provoked, then really, bottom line is, you're finding out you're more fleshy than you are spiritual. Provocation is just simply the opportunity for invocation to take it to the observation of what God may be doing in it to teach you about it so that you can learn from it, so that you can incorporate it in the way that you deal with it, so that you can deal with others in the same way. In other words, somebody provokes me on the internet all the time. I mean, it happens daily. I mean, it happens minutely. No, it happens all the time. No, I get provoked all the time. Provoked, you know, poked. You know, they poke me. You know, Facebook pokes. No, I'm kidding. I get one or two of those. People know I don't respond to them. It's like, I can't be poked. Sorry, just doesn't bother me. But when I get provoked, then I invoke the Spirit of God. Someone provokes me and I go, So then I stop and I go, Lord, what do you want me to say about this? You know, how do you want me to react to this? How do you want me to act about this? What do you want me to learn from this? What do you want me to do with this? How can I share this on the internet? How can I make this a living lesson, an object thing for me to grow thereby, and then also share it with someone else? And so everything that I'm provoked by causes me to invoke wisdom in my innermost part so that God could bring out from me inside some failing so I could share it on video, as well as open the doors. I had to think of what the word, what's God trying to say to me? Open the doors so that people can see inside me how I'm dealing with it and how I take it to the Lord, and then God restores me into right relationship with Him, causing me to use it as a bridge to step across in order to minister to the person who provoked me without them ever knowing that I was caught up in provocation by them, by their fleshy statement or whatever it may be, and used it as an opportunity to draw closer to God and then closer to them by taking from what I got from God to them, as well as how I failed in my own walk with the Lord by being provoked. So I always say, hey, poke the bear. Be poked. Be pokeable. Be provokeable. But know what to do when you are poked, provoked, or caused to go where you can grow best. That's really what it's all about. All of life is simply about do your best, pray that it's blessed, and Jesus takes care of the rest. Otherwise, get out from under mammon. Walk away from your idols. Cut back on your television time. You know, because you're watching television. Let's be honest, you are. You know that. I mean, come on. The necessity in life now is, you know, they always make up these little surveys and these little, you know, kind of statements of what it needs to be, what it takes to have a house, you know, what it takes to have a home, or what it takes to be alive, or what it takes to be not successful, but just to the minimum requirements for living. You know, nowadays it's washer, dryer, well, not washer, dryer, it's a house, you know, bed, TV, you know, those kind of things. But TV's on the list of necessities, a necessity of life. A TV? Really? You ever tried living without one? I have. I've done it. My wife and I just recently, because we've got no income coming in right now, technically. You know, we got some, but not much. Unemployment. Lord, please help. But the point is, we're on a limited income. So we had to, as soon as we knew that was going to happen, we slashed all of our non-essentials out of our life. At least almost all of them. We cut back our cable dramatically to where it's barely anything at all. We could get a little bit of news and a little bit of major channels and a lot of public channels, you know, and that's about it. And that's enough. We enjoy it because we have internet. We knew we needed internet, so we cut back on that. But we kept it to where we could still do the ministry, because that's why we have the internet. It's for ministry. We cut back on our activity level, you know, of going to drive-thrus. Man, I missed McDonald's. I missed my Costco pizza. Burger King? You know. But the reality is we couldn't afford it. We had to make different choices according to that with which we've been provided. So our necessity was not to be of the world and enjoying the world, but rather to step back, take a look at where we're at, and then say, what do we need and what has God provided? And then live according to the means that God has provided for us. And as such, we chose those things that direct our attention back to God rather than the idols which take us away from Him. Today, I would say, when you look at your summer vacations or you look at your observations of what society is going through and how your vocation is changing, your job and all these different things, try to understand where God is coming from when He deals with you in eternity. He wants you to learn not to serve or be served so much as to walk in the fullness of the life He's given you. I know this, beyond any shadow of a doubt, that's true about every one of these kinds of plants that you see this little kind of guy going. And you see these. Most of these that are huge blooms fill their pot. They are the fullness of God manifested, because I have trimmed them back. I have cut off some of their branches that were hanging over the side, that were extended out, that as soon as a storm could come, it would have broken off the branches and made it look kind of stupid, missing. But instead, I trimmed it back so that the roots would expand. And now it's got like root bound, but because it's got so much water, the word, coming into it, it constantly blooms. And because there's more blooms, it needs more of the word. So it has no time to do anything else except bloom and suck up the word. Sometimes that's what you need to realize. You need to have no more time for anything else except to bloom where you're planted and suck up the word, the water of the word, where you are. and you'll find that you'll fill the vessel that you are. It will fill your life to being root bound and found faithful unto Jesus Christ, the Word of God. Think about it. If you replay that and re-listen to it, you'll figure out what I mean by being root bound is found in the Word of God.